Hello, people. I am Jabby Kuwait, joined by Achara the Big Silly Kirk.
Hi.
And we're finally going to watch this Netflix video I've been wanting to watch for so long. It's Yours Sincerely, Kanan Gill. It's a stand-up special. If you're watching this on YouTube, you're going to see a 10-minute cut-down version of this. Hopefully it doesn't get blocked. Hopefully you guys are watching this. Hopefully I'm not just speaking to a camera and that's where it stops. At the very least, Patreon will get to watch this. If you're watching this on Patreon, you can watch the entire reaction uncut. However, you'll have to open up the Kanan Gill special in a separate window. We can't show the picture-in-picture because that's against them the rules there. And, yep. Okay, cool. Well, thanks so much for hanging out with us on YouTube, and thanks so much for supporting us on Patreon. Really appreciate it. We're going to get started here.
I was in North America.
In this
a coffee,
little clip.
Which is the national sport. When you walk in, you have to first say, hi, how are you? I'm good, thanks. How are you? I'm good as well. Hot outside, isn't it? Then you can begin speaking. In this much time, the population of India has doubled. Talk to an auntie. Hello, beta. Hello. What is your yearly salary?
His eyebrows.
All the airports now are silent airports. They don't make any announcements at the airport anymore. And they do this to prevent noise pollution. The country's running out of water, and they're like, at least they'll die quietly.
God.
Wow.
But thank you all for coming to watch the show. It's good time pass, no? That's an Indian concept. Time pass. Time pass is both an activity and a review of an activity. Works both ways. What are you doing? Time pass. How is the show? Oh, time pass. That's because time is relative. It's my uncle. Yeah. There you go. That's a PJ, I'll admit.
What's a PJ?
A parent joke?
I don't know. Okay. An Indian concept, by the way. PJs? Poor jokes.
Oh, poor joke.
It's usually some awful pun, right? What's the city you can't enter? Ethnicity. I was expecting laughter. That'll teach you to expect. Let's get to it. You're probably wondering why. So what is this show about? This show is basically about, I found a letter that I'd written to myself when I was 15 with a list of goals and things I had to accomplish by now that I am a different age. I found a letter. It goes like this. To Kanan, subject. Goals? Yeah, subject. It's a formal letter. What's the format of a formal letter? It's two, comma, then fucking below the comma, the address, which is inside the letter.
Yeah.
I always wondered about that.
How is it reaching? Goal one, focus on your health. I don't know if you've noticed because I'm wearing black and black. I've put on a considerable amount of weight. I weighed myself today. I weigh 100 kgs. Yeah. Which is not even a weight anymore.
It's like 220 pounds.
It's like a standard you can use to measure other things. How much does that car weigh? About 37 gills.
37 gills.
What can I do? I'm medically not allowed to exercise. It's true.
Why? Yeah.
See, I don't normally go to the doctor because I feel like if I go, they'll tell me I have some terminal disease, right? He's like, what's the problem? So I have a pain in my groin area. He's like, okay. So I am an ENT surgeon. What would you like me to do? He's like, so then what if I stood upside down? Goal number two. Focus on your education. Brackets, studies. Big difference. Education makes you a better person. Studies gets you a job. Studies is the way to be a great man. We were studying about a great man at the time. At the time, we were studying William Shakespeare's Julius Caesar, which if you... Okay. If you haven't read, it's time pass.
Way to bring that back.
Dude, in the starting of the play, they're like, we should kill Caesar. Then they kill him.
Yeah.
No twist. Nobody jumps in front, nothing.
Nope.
Or in the end, they're like, actually, it's all one guy. It's like Fight Club. Boom. 7 people stab Julius Caesar 23 times. Now, the last person who stabbed Caesar is his best friend, Brutus. And Brutus stabbed Caesar in the back for a metaphor. That was the first time that had ever happened. He stabbed him in the back by stabbing him in the back. And again, Caesar gets stabbed. He says the most famous lines in the play. He says,
et tu, Brute?
Which is Latin for you too, Brutus. And no one speaks in Latin at any other point.
That's true.
It's only one line.
Yeah.
Last words are important. Choose wisely. If you get stabbed, you're like, are yaar. So much of our education was based on memorization, right? But they call it learning by heart. Because the ultimate goal of the education system is to replace your heart with a textbook. So that you can never die. Because you've never lived. Oh. Okay, next goal. Take care of the dog. We used to have our dog when I was like 15. And he had a skin condition, which the vet said is because he licks himself too much. Doctor's like, no, he's just frustrated. So, because he wants to mate? So either you neuter him or get him mated. Obviously, not a decision the children take. Mom comes out, they've made a decision. She says the most gangster sentence she's said in her life. She said, Karan, tomorrow, we have to find some bitches.
I wonder if she actually said that.
Bitches. Now, some people provide a service where if you give them money, they will mate your dog with their dog. Takes us to the garden, the small white dog. He's like, this is my dog, Samantha. I'm like, what a fucking human name. to give to a dog. I was 15, feeling like shit anyway. Went to school, first thing in the morning, got birthday bumps. Rohit is standing there. I was like, Rohit, hold my watch. 2 minutes I will be back, Rohit. I will get kicked and come. Please give me my watch there. Rohit is like, no problem. Get kicked, come back. Rohit, where is my watch? It is not there. Not, I don't have it. It is not there. The watch is gone. Out of existence. He's like, why don't you check the lost and found department? Go to the lost and found department. That's an over-explained name. No? Just found is sufficient. Found by definition means it was lost. If you find things that aren't lost, that's stealing. Got kicked, watch gone, super upset. Come home, I was like, I need to take my mind off. Start playing video games, played Street Fighter. Losing at Street Fighter. And when you lose at Street Fighter, it's extremely harsh. Because on the screen, in big letters, it says, you lose. It doesn't say, you lost. It's making a general statement. Oh, you lose. Thought I'd play a different game. That year, landmark game had come out, called Grand Theft Auto 3. Oh, fans of GTA. First time in a video game, you could do anything you felt like. You could do whatever the fuck. But it was too much freedom for my mentality at the time. Like, you can do anything. Yes, but what are you supposed to do? And I looked it up and I found out exactly the shit you needed to do. Did all that, finished the game. End of the game, you get statistics, right? Which is how many times you've died, how many people you've killed. And a very interesting thing called completion percentage. And it said completion percentage, 12%. Yeah? I finished the game. That's 100%. No. You just reached the ending. But you only did 12% of all of the things you could have done. Well, fuck! What if life is like that? What if you die, you go to the afterlife, and they give you a report card? 3%. You didn't do any of the side missions. Like what? Like, see, here at a party, someone gave you a joint, you said no thanks. 15%? Next goal. If possible, it's not a good starting to a goal. Find love. That's the goal. Work your way towards if possible. I really like this girl. Let's call her Neha because that was her name. Good reason to call her Neha. This is pre-cell phone, so I called her landline. Sadness is a fundamental quantity in nature. It's not created or destroyed. It can only be transferred. If you're feeling sad, you go find someone. Hey, I'm feeling sad. Now they're sad. Say some shit to somebody else, they'll sad, do something else, make you sad again. That's how it works. It's the law of conservation of sadness. Came home one day, friend is sitting inside my house already. I'm like, hey man, Conan, feeling sad. I'm like, okay, well, that's what I'm here for, dude. Talk to me, textbook to textbook. Let's do this. I gave him the classic line, hey, if you ever need anything, just let me know. Ever say that to someone? Pretty dangerous statement. You're volunteering all of your services at any time. What do they call you now? 4 o'clock in the morning. And you know what they say? That failure is a stepping stone to our eventual suicide. They don't say that? Well, that's what happens in Julius Caesar. And by the end, every single person who stabbed Caesar gets killed or kills themselves, including Brutus, who's in a unique dilemma because he wants to kill himself. But if he kills himself, no one will remember him as being noble. So he's like, what the fuck do I do? Calls a friend. Hey man, feeling sad. If you ever need anything. Glad you asked, actually. Can you hold my sword over there for 1 minute? The guy's like, yo, why you want me to hold your sword? And then Brutus runs on the sword, stabs himself, and dies that way. Dude, fuck! What's wrong with you? You've just made me murder you! You said if I ever needed... Yeah, not anything, anything. Aham gachami. I remember back then asking my English teacher, I was like, what is a metaphor? Like, Karan, a metaphor is kind of like a simile, but like without like. Karan, why aren't you understanding? Now, because our English teacher was also our maths teacher, he's like, you know how in maths class I explain to you problems on the board? Well, the purpose that that board serves as a tool of explanation is the same purpose that a metaphor serves as a part of speech in conversation. I think I'm having a stroke, actually. Went home, came back the next day. I was like, I got it! So the conversation we had yesterday is a metaphor for how bad you are as a teacher.
Damn.
Best thing is, many of you came to the show knowing what a metaphor was. And now, you're not so sure anymore.
True.
Found this letter and it reminded me how miserable I used to be. Thought I would achieve all these goals, then it would be fine. But it's not fine. I've done this, done everything on the 10 other sheets. I was like, is my whole point of view on life wrong? Have I somehow stabbed myself in the back? Got so mind-fucked. Came home, didn't know what to think. Friend is sitting at home. Hey, man. I was like, not today. Hey, man. I'm feeling sad. If you ever need anything, you know I'm here. Talk to me, textbook to textbook. I was like, read this letter. Isn't this fucked up? Yeah, dude. You know the date is on the left, right? Yeah. What? I'm just trying to finish life at 100%. Trying to live life to the fullest. He's like, hey, how much ever you live, life is full. You're not going to die and someone will say, hey, you left a little bit. Finish. I don't want to put it in the fridge. Finish. Yeah, man, but when are goals supposed to end? Karan, you can do whatever you want for however long you want and then you can declare. The answer is not out there. It's in here. In your textbook. Thanks, I guess, man. Here I am trying to climb Mount Everest. You know what's at the top of Mount Everest? It's the bodies of the people who failed and the garbage of the people who succeeded. It's not a smart endeavor on the whole. So Mount Everest is a metaphor. Right? No, idiot, the letter is a metaphor. The whole thing, that was the metaphor. Letaphor. Oh, you know so much about the letter? I'm not even real. I'm just someone you made up in the show. Talk about your own depression.
Oh.
So this is like Fight Club. Yeah, I mean, I guess that's not the moral you should be taking away from this piece of art. This is not art.
day. What the hell?
This isn't art. This is time pass. Aham gachami.
The song's actually really good.
At the end?
Yeah, I like it.
The outro song?
Yeah.
Yeah, I liked it too. Anywho, that was a very, very interesting show.
Yes.
Let me say this before anything. I really enjoyed this. Any criticisms I express is as a fan of Kanon Gill and as someone who does not do stand-up comedy. I write comedic stuff into my scripts, my little scripts here and there, and I try to make jokes, but I am by no means a stand-up comic, so who the heck am I to make a criticism of Kanon Gill or any stand-up comedian for that matter. That's my preface for anything I say. This is a very, very like competently made stand-up comedy show where everything is like, it comes back around multiple times over.
Yeah, like it was very tight.
Yeah.
Because there were certainly things where I was like, I'm not sure where this is going,
right.
But okay, we're in this now. And then it's very satisfying to kind of see how he calls back to things that he set up like right from the beginning of the show.
Right. It's a very intellectual comedy piece. It's like, it's not so much like the belly laughs, the ha ha's, like there is a cow, like belly laughs, though I had a few of those.
Yeah.
In some instances, I don't think that like, it's like sometimes he does things that I think I only find hilarious because you weren't laughing and the audience wasn't laughing, but I was laughing.
Yeah.
And so I find him particularly interesting, and his method, his approach to comedy and writing in general is particularly interesting. I listened to him talk in the Netflix thing with Kenny Sebastian.
The Dosa thing,
yeah. And his approach is so methodical. It's like he really, really thinks about all of his jokes. And you can tell when you watch his stand-up just how much thought he puts into the whole thing. Though he said it's not art, it is art. It's like he was really trying to make this cohesive thing as opposed to random off-the-cuff stuff.
Yeah, or like random stories.
Yeah, random stories. I mean, well, seemingly random. Like you watch a Bill Burr special and it feels seemingly random, like he's just chatting with you. But it's sort of stuff he just cobbles together over the course of 2 years, right?
Right.
And so where this is like he will go over it again and again and again and refine his stuff to the point that like I almost wonder what like 6 drafts ago this looked like.
Right.
You know, because sometimes you go over your own jokes and you're like, oh, that's not funny anymore, but it's like it might have been funny the first time, so maybe you should keep it. And it's like it's hard to know that when you're so critical of your own stuff. He's a perfectionist is ultimately what I'm trying to get to, right? And so there are two sides to that. Like on the one hand, you have this very extremely well-crafted show where it's so cohesive and for all intents and purposes perfect, right? But on the other hand, it's sort of there are elements in there that just don't have the same sort of like punch to it, the same sort of like haha-ness, because it's not like it doesn't feel off the cuff, right?
Yeah, it feels a little bit
prepared.
Rehearsed.
Yeah,
because everything is just so perfectly set up. But like, but what I do appreciate about him is the performative aspect of his comedy.
Yeah.
Like, I really like his acting, as it were.
Yes.
You know, like the way he does the different characters. I love his facial expressions. Like sometimes it's not even the things that he's saying, it's in the looks that he gives to the audience. Can you believe that? And like I really enjoy that.
His expressions are very much on point. I've been wanting to say this the entire show. He reminds me of an Indian John Bernthal. His face structurally reminds me so much of John Bernthal.
Huh.
Like his nose, everything. John Bernthal is just like a bigger version of him. It's like I know that I'm probably the only one who thinks that. I see weird things in other things, but like that's what I started thinking. Like 30 minutes in, I'm like, he looks just like John Bernthal to me.
Oh, that's weird.
It's just an odd thing. And the funniest thing is I noticed his weight and then he called it out.
Yeah, I noticed it too, but I was also thinking like, god damn it, he's so lucky, because just from the neck up, you can't tell.
Yeah, you can't
that
tell.
He's put on weight.
He's also got a beard.
I know, but I'm so jealous because I'm like, when I put on weight, it distributes evenly everywhere. And sometimes I just wish that I was that type of person that could be like, just look at my face.
Yeah.
Face looks like perfectly fine and slim.
One of the interesting things about this show was how much he has you walking out thinking about. Because like there's just a lot of just philosophical stuff. He sort of slips in there like a Trojan horse and you don't even realize. But there's a lot of thinky stuff, kind of like Aziz Ansari's special that we watched.
Yeah.
Where it's like he leaves you with a lot of stuff to digest. And you're like, wait, I came for a comedy show.
I know. That was like the only stand-up comedy show I've watched where I cried.
Oh, Aziz Ansari.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That was I mean, that's crazy. Anyway, we're talking about Kanungil.
Like, when he brought up the video game stuff, obviously I can relate to that. I play video games.
Yeah.
And he's the Street Fighter thing. Like, I know the feeling he's talking about, but the way in which he put a magnifying glass on it was so profound. He's like, you lose. Continue. You do get that feeling of like, ugh, it's just utter defeat and it sucks. And you have to keep going until you win because it's just like a drug, like cocaine or something, right? And then he got to the Grand Theft Auto thing. And I've experienced that where, like, I beat this open world sandbox game and it's like, yeah, you beat 2% of the game. Like, what? How? I just put like 20 hours into this thing. What are you talking about? Because they just throw in so much shit. But then he used that as a metaphor for life.
A metaphor?
Yeah. Exactly. He temporarily broke the definition of metaphor in my head.
Yeah.
But like, he used Grand Theft Auto as a metaphor for life. And I thought that was actually very interesting because it did make you think, like, how much do I not do in my own life? Like, I have certain things that make me feel certain inhibitions that I've admitted on YouTube, like I'm a clean freak. And so there's certain inhibitions that come with being someone who's a OCD.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like when you have OCDs about certain things, you're limiting yourself from other things. And I do think about that on a very like philosophical, deep level of like, Jesus, like, what am I keeping myself from enjoying because of this that other people get to enjoy because they don't have that? And so that's interesting. Just the notion of like, what are you saying no to your whole life?
Yeah.
What are you saying no to? And then he gets to the end of it. He's like, well, that's not really what life is. No one's handing you a glass saying you didn't finish this.
Yeah.
And so
it is what you make of it.
Yeah. He's introducing two diametrically opposed concepts in the same show. So it feels just like a philosophy class. It's frustrating like a philosophy class because you go out going, I don't know anything. And that's what a philosophy class does to you, is it introduces an idea and you have certain preconceived notions of what you're supposed to feel about this thing. And the philosophy teacher goes, well, what about this, 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 and this? And then you're like, what? And then your brain feels like it's exploding because you can't make up your mind about what you're supposed to feel. And so, yeah, this is a comedic philosophy class.
Yeah, I mean, he's definitely very, very thinky. And what I appreciate as well is just how he looks at things in a different way. And I think that's crucial to comedy, is looking at the everyday, but kind of with a different lens. And it's like what he did with the there is a cow joke, where it's like, oh, you know, there is a cow, however he explained it. But here he does that too, where he'll just kind of take things that you just take for granted and then be like, wait, why do we say that? I think he's making interesting observations on the education system in India. And I think that's why, you know, a lot of people were finding the joke super relatable and funny. And maybe sometimes we kind of missed them. But it seems like, you know, he talks a lot about this rote learning that happens a lot in, you know, the Indian school system. Everything is like memorization and you're just trained to become these textbooks and stuff.
Like Pavlov's dog.
Yeah, and like he just kind of talks about it in a way that is really cool, and it makes you think. And then I love that whole like, let's have a conversation textbook to textbook.
Right.
And it's like, yeah.
I don't think the commentary on schooling was entirely lost on us. I mean, obviously there are nuances and deeper rooted ideas that we're not going to get because we didn't go to school in India. But I think that the overarching notions, the important aspect of it, or the bigger picture notions, I think we got them just fine, because I think that wherever you are in the world, you can sort of relate to those ideas where it sort of turns you into a machine or a cog in the machine as opposed to an individual.
Right. Yeah. I mean, I think you're right, but I think there are also a lot of things in the
Indian school system
that's just really different than if you go to school in the West, you know?
Well, I mean, like, I don't know. Like, I really feel like the American school system turns you into a robot, turns you into a worker bee. And I feel like that's true pretty much everywhere in the world, because you need employees to run businesses. And what better way to do that than to train them from the time they're a child to be an employee, to think like an employee.
Right.
You got to turn in by a certain time, you leave at a certain time, you punch in, punch out, and you're doing these tasks. You don't know why you're doing them, but you have to in order to make the man happy, in order to make your parents happy.
Follow the rules. Play the game.
Yeah.
Like, don't do the sandbox thing like in GTA 3.
That's so funny. That, like, him mentioning that, I'm glad you brought that up, because like, I felt the exact same way when I played Grand Theft Auto. I'm like, I have no structure here. I don't know what to do. What am I supposed to do? Even playing Grand Theft Auto 5, I'm like, I have no idea what I'm supposed to do with this free time. I need structure in a video game in order to have, like, a lot of people play the online, massive multiplayer online games.
Yeah.
And I get a little frustrated. I'm like, there's no objective, though, other than to, like, it's just, like, sparring. There's no, like, story to this.
Right.
And I need that sort of structure in order to have enjoyment from it. It's so strange. And I guess that's what I took from school. I don't know. But his recounting of Julius Caesar, how accurate was that? I mean, I know he's being hyperbolic and making jokes and whatnot and modernizing it with his jokes, but, like, is that pretty much what happened?
Yeah.
But, like, he said, I got a little confused by the numbers. So he said he was stabbed 23 times?
I don't remember it exactly, but yeah, he was stabbed a whole bunch.
Like Jon Snow?
Yeah, because he was turned against people. It was pretty much like Jon Snow. People just were like, oh no, we don't agree with his policies and stuff anymore. He needs to go. And so they all plotted to kill him, including his best friend.
What happened with Brutus?
Brutus.
What happened with him?
I think it is. He fell on his sword.
Okay.
I don't remember the...
Is that where the saying comes from? Falling on your own sword?
Yeah. I mean, I don't remember.
So both sayings come from him? Both sayings come from that character, stabbed in the back and then falling on your own sword?
I guess so. I mean, Shakespeare propagated a lot of words. Like, did you know bubble was a word that Shakespeare invented?
I did not know. That's a cute word.
From Macbeth.
Okay. What does
there
it mean?
You go. It means bubble.
It just built like bubbles?
Like bubbles.
Okay, so he made that word up.
Yeah.
The thing about the letter also was, I mean, what I love about Kenan Gill is how he takes apart the things that we take for granted. Like, especially because it's introduced to us at such a young age, we have no choice but to take it for granted, such as the letter. Like, why does it have to be on this side, the date or whatever?
That's so confusing.
And why do we have to include the address in the letter that is, like, how... You're going to put it on the envelope anyhow. Like,
it's a formal letter.
Yeah, like, but why? And so, I always enjoy how he takes apart the things that we just take for granted.
Yeah. It was interesting as well how at the end of the special, it kind of took this turn to be about depression. And, like,
the sad clown is, like, every comedian, isn't
it? Well, yeah, exactly. And I was kind of like, oh, man, like, I feel kind of bad for him. Like, he's making fun of himself as a depressed 15-year-old who's just hoping that his life will get better. And then later on, he just kind of has this moment where he's kind of baring his soul and being like, yep, I'm depressed. And then, ha 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 ha!
Who's that Aussie comedian that has a show on Comedy Central, like a news show like Jon Stewart on Comedy Central?
Oh, the one who used to be an alcoholic?
Yes, that one.
I don't remember his name.
I don't remember his name either. Shoot. But yeah, there's an Australian comedian who talks about that as well. He talks about his depression very openly on the stage. There is this like uncomfortable moment because you realize like what this person's actually going through inside while you're laughing.
Yeah.
You know, like it's the Robin Williams thing where he's like making you laugh because that's the only way that he can function.
Yeah.
But inside there's like this
pain
and sadness that he's constantly dealing with. The interesting thing that he brought up, because you said that, it reminded me, is he checked off all his goals and he was still like, this is it?
Yeah.
Like, you're left with this sort of void still that isn't filled. And it's so bizarre because, you know, Jim Carrey said a long time ago, like, you know, people think that wealth and fame will bring you happiness, but you still have to deal with you at the end of the day. Mm-hmm. And I always remembered that because I'm like, well, wouldn't it be better to have money? Like, you're not going to be as sad otherwise. But like, you get to a certain point in your own life where you have a certain, you know, modest amount of success, or I don't know how you want to phrase that. But like, you get to it and you're like, I'm still dealing with me though.
Yeah.
I still have to deal with my own idiosyncrasies and conundrums and weird shit that go through my mind. It's like, there's just more time for more of it now to think about and focus on. And you're not necessarily doing anything about it because it's, you know, I don't want to go down my own rabbit hole of bullshit. All I'm just saying is like, no matter what, no matter where you are in terms of your status, you still have to deal with you at the end of the day.
Right.
And so, yeah, he was bringing that up and that's interesting because like basically what he was trying to say is like setting those goals and accomplishing those goals are not necessarily the key to happiness, but I do think it does bring you at least a moderate amount of happiness, you know?
Well, it can be very satisfying to tick off the goals on your list.
Yeah, like for me, making my bed in the morning, which is like a military thing as well, that actually brings me a certain degree of joy, like I did something.
Mm-hmm.
And it gives me a certain amount of fulfillment, and that fulfillment does equate to a certain amount of happiness for me. Not to make this about me or, you know, get too philosophical, but that's sort of what this is making me think about.
Sure.
Yeah, so overall, I mean, I enjoyed the show quite a bit, and I thought that it was a very thinky show. I would have loved to have traded some of the thinky stuff for more there is a cow ha-has.
Yeah.
You know, I almost wish that he... that joke in this special. I know that would be stupid. That's a faux pas. But like, you know, I just was looking forward to more of that. I got sort of Trojan horse here with a lot of thinky stuff. In the end, I don't mind it. I don't regret it because it was worthwhile. It was interesting. And it does give me like some food for thought.
Yeah.
I was just sort of expecting a little bit, I hate to put it this way, I was expecting a little bit mindless fun. Not a lot of mindful stuff that you then have to digest and now you got to go and wrestle with that shit.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, true.
Cool. You guys, thanks so much for hanging out with us. Hopefully you enjoyed that. And let us know your feelings in the comments below. If you're watching this on YouTube, please subscribe and hit that bell icon. Get all notifications. That would mean a lot to the Jabs and to the Achas over here. And if you're watching this on the Patreon, thanks so much for supporting us. Very, very much appreciate it. Y'all, thanks so much for hanging out. I'm Jabby Coy. This is
Achara Kirk.
Peace out.